For worship, please join me in praying the Collect for Purity, which is printed in your bulletin or right here for you to see. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our hymn of praise is Fairest Lord Jesus. We will sing all three verses. Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask, and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness, and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not, and for our blindness we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now we will hear the lessons.
The first lesson comes from Isaiah 44, 6 through 8. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Who is like me? Let them proclaim it. Let them declare and set it forth before me. Who has announced from old the things to come? Let them tell us what is yet to be. Do not fear or be afraid. I have not told you from of old and declared it. You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? There is no other rock. I know not one. The word of the Lord. The psalm appointed for this Sunday is Psalm 86, verses 11 through 17. We'll read this all together. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Knit my heart to you, that I may fear your name. I will thank you, O Lord, my God, with all my heart, and glorify your name forevermore. For great is your love toward me. You have delivered me from the nethermost pit. The arrogant rise up against me, O God, and a band of violent men seeks my life, and have not set you before their eyes. But you, O Lord, are gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and full of kindness and truth. Turn to me and have mercy upon me. Give your strength to your servant, and save the child of the handmaid. Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be ashamed, because you, O Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Romans 8, verses 12 through 25. Brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the Spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that my Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves. We have the first fruits of the Spirit, grown inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies, for in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The sequence hymn is Bring Forth the Kingdom of God, and we'll sing verses 1 and 2 before the gospel reading, and verse 3 after.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus put before the crowd another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slaves said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Bring forth the kingdom of mercy. Bring forth the kingdom of
Be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, last week we had a parable of a sower. This week we have another parable about sowing seed. These would be great messages for Rogation Days when we're talking about planting and harvesting. But last week when we talked about the seed was the Word of God, and we were the earth. And the question was, are you hard? Is it impossible to penetrate into you because you're so hard? Or are you the kind of soil that is full of rocks, and so there's no place for really deep roots? Or perhaps you're the kind of soil that's already so full of weeds and thorns and briars that no seed would have any chance of growing. Or perhaps you're that field that's been prepared and is just waiting for that seed to fall. And that seed will generate much, much fruit. Well, today we have a different parable, and in this one, things are a little bit different. In fact, Matthew gives Jesus' explanation for this. But a parable is a whole lot like a piece of art, whether it's a sculpture or a painting or even music. One sees one thing and somebody else sees something else and somebody else sees something else. So we're going to parse this and see what really great things we can glean from it. For one thing, in the early church, and I'm talking about the first 300 or 400 years, there was a real tendency for people to want purity. In fact, before Jesus' death and resurrection, the Pharisees were already trying to be a purity group. The Essenes out in the wilderness, trying to be a purity group. They wanted to keep everybody out that wasn't as holy as they were, wasn't as righteous as they were. And so this particular parable that deals with the seed being sown, and the seed is us being sown in good soil, but somebody comes along and plants rotten seed. But it looks so much like us that it's hard to tell the difference. And so the gardeners say, well, should we go get rid of all those bad seeds? And he says, no, because when you start messing with the roots, you're liable to pluck out the good ones too. Just leave them alone. When they become mature, it'll be obvious which are the good seed and which are not. St. Augustine believed that that parable spoke specifically to the church. That the church wasn't supposed to be so interested in purity and weeding out those people that they felt were just not the right folk. But let them all grow up together. Be with them. Let the sandpaper of those experiences hone us and make us stronger. You might also think of our own hearts. If we think of our hearts being the soil, as the other sower's story was, that perhaps in our own hearts there's good seed and bad seed planted and growing up. And Paul spoke of that. The good that I would do, I'm not doing. And those things I don't want to find myself doing, that's exactly what I find myself doing. And who's going to deliver me? We talked about mixed motives, about how we're going to have mixed motives all of our lives. We're going to have those two realities that we have to deal with within ourselves. It reminds me of an old Native American story about the two wolves. The old Indian elder told this young boy, said, every person has two wolves growing inside them. And the boy says, wow, well, what kind of wolves? So, well, there's one really, really wonderful, noble, generous and gentle, kind but strong and courageous. That's one wolf. And the other one, oh, the other one is selfish and greedy and eager and violent. And they're always fighting. And the little boy said, well, Grandpa, who wins? And he was told, the one you feed. Which one are you feeding? That's the one who wins. I love that story because it really does speak to the fact that we always have this battle in us, and sometimes we don't pay enough attention to feeding what is good, to guarding our minds, and guarding our behavior, guarding what we see and read and listen, taking care that our time actually represents our love for God, rather than representing our love for recreation or amusement or escape. We need to spend time with God if we're going to become godly. That just makes sense. So if that is the message here, that's a possible message. We see that it's a timeless message, because that Native American story came from centuries past. And in Wales, they had a very similar story with two dragons. This reality exists in us. It exists in the church. It exists in the world. And the thing we have to be so careful of is when it exists in ourselves. Remember, he said that the wheat and the tares, the problem with them is they look so much alike. It would be hard not to destroy the good when you're trying to pull out the bad. Sometimes we confuse our self-righteousness with righteousness. Sometimes they can look really similar. Sometimes we can put on masks and parade around like we're holy people. But it's not reality. And so we have to be very diligent in that. But there's hope. At the end of the gospel reading, we're told that God is going to come along at the end and remove all that from us. We won't have this struggle anymore. We'll be able to be the people we want to be. We'll be able to love like we want to love and receive love like we want to. And we won't have to be self-righteous or pretentious or pious in a negative sense. We will be. We will just be who we are meant to be. So today, as you meditate on this message, I want you to think about what you're eating, what you're taking in, which wolf are you feeding? We don't want to have too big a harvest at the end of the wicked. Let's have a harvest of great, healthy, and holy wheat. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for these simple stories that have such powerful meanings. And these were just two different ways of looking at a parable. And there's so many other ways. The same is true of your holy book, the Bible. Every time I read it, I can read from the same passage and get a deeper and more profound meaning. Sometimes I'm amazed at what's highlighted. I think, wow, wonder what was happening in my life that was so important that I highlighted that. Because that's not the deep part. This other part is really great. Encourage us to read your word, to pray, to worship, to keep our time, your time, so that we will be the people you want us to be. And your kingdom will be established right here on this earth. This we pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you'll look in your bulletins or on our screens, we'll say together the Nicene Creed. We trust in one God, the Creator, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We trust in Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, begotten eternally of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through whom all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We trust in the Holy Spirit, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, and with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, universal, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. With all our heart and all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. For your church, especially those who guide us, that they may be filled with your Spirit and faithful in their leadership, Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Antonio Gen. Scott, our bishop, Stephanie, our priest, and Colleen, our deacon. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For this nation and the world, especially Antonio, Secretary General of the United Nations, Donald, our president, Pete, our governor, and Stan, our mayor, that your justice and mercy and salvation, O God, may reach to the ends of the earth, and all peoples know of your faithfulness and your deliverance. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those rejoicing in family and personal celebrations, birthdays, anniversaries, graduations, new employment, retirement, and more, give them and us a sense of awe as we consider your goodness and all the works of your hands. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our local community, for our friends and neighbors, guide us by the light and wisdom of the Holy Spirit to be the friends and neighbors that we want our friends and neighbors to be. Guide us to be the mature and responsible citizens we need in our community to promote what is best for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As we each call to mind those in need of your healing and strength, we ask you to send the Holy Spirit to stimulate healing and lift the burden of despair, and to put in their hearts and on their lips a new song of praise. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For those who have died, embrace them in your love. For those who mourn, may they know the comfort of your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Almighty and eternal God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you for the honor and privilege that you afford us in calling us to pray, to intercede on behalf of ourselves and others. Mercifully accept the prayers of your people and send your Holy Spirit to be present in grace and power to them and us, and grant our requests as may be best for us all. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Announcement is this. I wanted to remind those of you who are sitting at home enjoying this service on television
that worship is not a spectator sport. So I encourage you every Sunday, please participate, sing along, read with us, get involved in the service. Because if it doesn't feel quite like you've worshiped, maybe you haven't. You have to contribute to worship to feel like you've worshiped. So take that to heart. As far as our worshiping together, the vestry and I are preparing a letter for the bishop. Our hope is that we will begin having services in August. They'll still be limited to around 10 people, depending if we have families that make it possible to have a few more because the whole family can sit in one pew. But that's sort of the goal, is to keep it limited and have the services right here in the church, although probably halfway back so that we don't have to move all of the equipment, because we will continue having our online services. So be in prayer about that. There'll be things that we expect of people who come, like wearing masks, being sure your hands are washed and your temperature was taken before you come. If you haven't, we'll have a thermometer right here for you. Because we want to keep everyone safe. But that's our goal, and I'll give you more information as we go along. Other thing is, we still have coffee hour. Now, coffee hour starts somewhere between 11:30 and 11:45. People began coming in. So that means you have time to get up off the couch and go ahead and brush your hair and put on a decent shirt. That sometimes keeps people from coming to coffee hour, I hear. So let that not be your reason for not joining us on Zoom for coffee hour. And you'll have that information in a constant contact, so be sure you check your email. And now walk in love as Christ loves us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God, bringing all your gifts and your tithes together so that we might bless them. And while you're doing that, our band will provide for us an offertory.
Oh,
please gather together and put your hands on top of that offering that you're about to send. Let us pray. Holy One, we acknowledge that everything we have and everything we are is a gift from you. The warm sun that shines by day, the moon and stars by night, the water that refreshes and cleanses us, the fresh air that we breathe, the many life forms that delight us daily, butterflies, birds, deer, family, pets, this good earth that provides our food and the materials for everything we use. We thank you for the honor you have given us to use these gifts and to love and care for them. So today, we lift our tithes and offerings before you, giving back to you some of the bounty that we have been able to generate. Bless and multiply these offerings to further your dream for this world and for all who make their home here. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now hear these scriptures before we have a spiritual communion. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, that whoever believes in, trusts in, and relies on him will not perish, but have eternal life. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. I am the living bread, which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he or she will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in them. And now let us pray together in the words our Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Dear Lord Jesus Christ, we stand in union with the faithful at every altar of your church, where the sacrament of your blessed body and blood are being offered to the Father. We offer to you our praise and thanksgiving. Scripture tells us that you inhabit the praises of your people, and we believe that you are truly present in this moment. Since we cannot receive you sacramentally, we ask you, through the power of the Holy Spirit, to come spiritually into our beings, into our heart of hearts. We unite ourselves to you and embrace you with all the affections of our souls. May we never be separated from you. Come, Lord Jesus, dwell in your servants, in the fullness of your strength, in the perfection of your ways, and in the holiness of your spirit, and empower us in us the might of your spirit to fully live our lives in love and to the glory of the Father. Amen. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve our bodies and souls into everlasting life. And the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you, within you, and among you, now and forever. Amen.
And let us go forth into the world in peace and joy to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.